The Eternal Light. The National Broadcasting Company and its affiliated independent stations present The Eternal Light, the Peabody Award-winning program which comes to you under the auspices of the Jewish Theological Seminary of America. Today we present the second in a series of four conversations with distinguished leaders of modern thought. Our guest is Dr. Oscar Handlin, Winthrop Professor of History at Harvard University. He will be interviewed by NBC News correspondent Ed Goff. Dr. Oscar Handlin is not only Winthrop Professor of History at Harvard, where he's taught for the past 25 years, but is also a Pulitzer Prize-winning author in his field. And his field is social history, the effect of people, all kinds of people, on the life and growth of this nation. His writing has ranged from his earliest studies of Boston's immigrants, the Irish, through his epic portrayal of the great tides of immigration to America in The Uprooted. It was for The Uprooted that he was awarded the Pulitzer Prize for History in 1952. His most recent book, The Americans, A Social History of the People of the United States, will soon be published. Professor Handlin's concentration on the internal forces that have shaped our history has led, perhaps inevitably, to an additional responsibility at Harvard, that of the director of the Center for the Study of the History of Liberty in America. Dr. Handlin, is it possible to indicate briefly just what your center is up to, what kind of studies you're now undertaking?
We were asked about 5 years ago whether American scholarship couldn't provide some answers to questions that people were wondering about: the character of liberty, the course of its development, the prospects for its future in the United States. And we've enlisted some 25 or 30 scholars in an effort to help supply the materials for those answers. Of course, we discovered early on that there were great differences of opinion about what liberty was, and we have not tried to give any fixed formula that defines the term. Instead, we have tried to generate a number of books and studies that will begin to appear through this year and in the next 4 years that will supply us with some of the data that Americans ought to know about liberty in their lives. Now, some of these subjects are very close to current concerns, but generally they fall into three categories that deal with the essential problems that must be encountered by people who wish to be free. We deal with the character of the government and its relationship to the population. We deal with those things that people are able to do cooperatively for themselves without the intercession of government. And we deal with the promises, the prospects that people expect from life that make their existence worthwhile and give them a sense of attachment to the community. Thus, we've had a book on the concept of citizenship, what it is that makes people feel not subjects but participants in government. We've had books on various ethnic groups and the way in which they develop their forms of action independently of government. And finally, we have extensive studies of social mobility, of how people are able to move through life, achieving the goals that are important to them in their own way, through their own efforts.
I'm curious, Dr. Handlin, whether there's any connection between the fact that you're a child of Jewish immigrant parents and your professional concentration on the subject.
Not directly. Harvard was more responsible for the character of my interest than was the birthplace of my parents. I came up here to study history, and it was here through the intellectual questions that were raised by my teachers and by my studies that I first became involved with the Irish in Boston, a subject fairly remote from my own background. But as I proceeded to work in this subject more intensely, I found links to my own background, my own character, the environment I had known. Those, I think, indirectly made the subject more meaningful to me.
Well, in one of your books entitled Adventures in Freedom, you concentrated on the Jewish immigrants. Can you tell us some of the highlights of their struggle to gain acceptance?
Well, they were fortunate in that they came in the United States to a place that was propitious for giving them a secure and free situation in society. By the time large numbers of Jews arrived in the United States, there was already an atmosphere that encouraged religious equality, and there was already an atmosphere that insisted on treating all people equally, and one that permitted abilities to assert themselves at all levels of the social scale. So the kind of place to which the Jewish immigrants came was of initial and continuing importance in their adjustment. But in addition, the Jews brought with them cultural and social traits that helped them fit into this environment, for the most part, very acceptably. Their tradition of learning, their emphasis on achievement and on the ability of the individual to assert himself, all these qualities were very important in their adjustment. So it was both the place and the people coming together that in the long run made possible their success in their struggle to gain acceptance.
Doctor, you say that when they came, they found an attitude of religious freedom. Was this an actual attitude, or was this something that the people in America at that time, and at this time perhaps, pay only lip service to?
No, it was more than lip service that was involved. It was, in a way, a condition of American society. In a pluralistic country, and this country was pluralistic even before independence, much before independence, it was very difficult to achieve the dominance of one group over another. In Massachusetts, for instance, the superior group were the Puritans, but along came members of the Church of England. They couldn't be discriminated against because it was, after all, the official church, so you had to make an adjustment that would take in both groups. In Pennsylvania, the dominant group were the Quakers, but elsewhere they were, had been persecuted. So that just in the character of the life that was being led here, the mixture of different kinds of groups and sects, pragmatically it worked out. The only way they could get together, live together, was through tolerance. And then in addition, there did develop theories about religious equalities through the influence of Baptist groups, Catholics, later Jews. But all those theories rested on the initial social fact that you had different kinds of people who had to live together.
Well, in your studies of all the various immigrant groups, have you found a common pattern of acceptance and rejection for all, or did each ethnic group seem to have a specially flavored discrimination to buck?
Well, it was not altogether a common pattern. There were common elements. New and different people always meet the suspicion and mistrust of those among whom they come. But the particular way in which that is expressed depends on the character of the group and on the place into which it comes. For instance, when the Irish came to Boston in the 1840s and 1850s, they were mistrusted because of their Catholicism, because of their poverty, and because of their strangeness. And the same period in Boston, the Germans were well regarded. But if we look in those very decades in Texas or in the South generally, we find the reverse situation. The Irish seemed to fit in better. The Germans, who were often abolitionists, had met a lot of hostility in the South. Later, we find groups which are quite strange, like the Armenians, who nevertheless come into a favorable social situation in California, New England, and who are very sympathetically regarded. On the other hand, the Italians at first are treated as among the lowest of the population groups, and it's only gradually that they achieve a more favorable recognition. So there are two components in prejudice and discrimination among immigrant groups. First, the character of the group and the preconceived image that Americans have about it, and secondly, the kind of social situation into which they move.
Well, in the past 60 years, there's been a great change in our immigration policies. Why is this so?
Well, in part, it's a result of the maturity of the country and the feeling that it's settled and so on. But I think that the important elements in that change come from more specific sources. Our immigration policies changed in the years between 1917 and 1924. We're stuck with the policies we adopted in those 7 years. Now, those 7 years, as you remember, were years of isolationism. Immigration restriction was in the same category, in the same pattern, as the refusal to join the League of Nations, the high tariff barriers that were created in those years, the feeling of 100% Americanism. All these were expressions of fear that the United States could somehow not get involved with what was going on in the rest of the world. And immigration was one of the links that bound us to other countries. We cut that link just as we tried to cut other forms of involvement.
You speak of being stuck with a policy of immigration of the years before 1924, but here we are in the 60s and we're solidly committed to a policy of internationalism. Why have we continued to cling to these isolationistic policies in immigration?
Well, there's a difference here. First of all, there's no big vested interest that wants a change in the laws. It doesn't seem to be closely related to anyone's practical concerns, and therefore the issue can be put off from year to year. And secondly, Congress, which is most responsible for formulating laws, prefers a status quo policy because of its makeup. Congress predominantly reflects the rural and agricultural parts of the country. These people don't see any direct relevance to their own situation in immigration policy. So that although every president from Roosevelt, Truman, Eisenhower, down to Kennedy has asked for a change, Congress has always been able to evade the necessity of facing up to the issue and dealing with it realistically in the light of our current situation.
Well, at least one member of Congress, Senator Jacob Javits of New York, has been calling recently for changes in our immigration policies. In what way would you like to see our policies altered?
I think our policies should be more realistic and reflect more directly our present position. And first of all, the quota system, which is still part of the law, is based on racial assumptions that most Americans no longer hold, the assumptions that the people of Northern Europe are somehow inherently superior to the people of Southern Europe. We certainly ought to get rid of those assumptions. In the second place, the policy ought to be more flexible. We say now that 150,000 immigrants can enter the country each year, although we make it impossible for that number ever actually to come in without special exceptions. This is pointless. There are years when we have substantial unemployment and don't need immigration. There have been years since the war when immigration of more than 150,000 would be necessary. So I think we ought to have a system very much like our present tariff system, in which the levels are not rigid but are adjusted to needs from year to year. And finally, I think that there ought to be room in the present immigration policy for expressing those interests and values which serve the nation in some direct and meaningful way. If we spend hundreds of millions of dollars on foreign aid, if we are involved in political and ideological conflicts with countries across the Iron Curtain, we ought to use immigration policy as one of the instruments for helping us to attain the objectives that the country considers valuable. And I'll give just one example, that of the Hungarian refugees. When these people left their country as a result of their uprising against communism, we were caught in the embarrassing situation in which we couldn't accept as many as a tiny little country like Switzerland. And we finally did take a substantial number, but only by evading the law and by securing all sorts of special provisions through the action of the president. But there ought to be some way in which we could use immigration policy directly, consciously, and actively in a crisis such as this.
Well, Dr. Handlin, the people who want freer immigration now seem to talk about freer immigration for, as you say, perhaps Southern Europeans. Do you think that if there was a communist takeover of some Asian country and there was a crowd of refugees out of an Asian country, that there would be the same feeling, let's take in these immigrants? Or do you think there's still a feeling?
Well, if it were a question of numbers. Now, I don't know whether you remember the incident about a year and a half ago at Hong Kong when suddenly, as a result of famine in Chinese, communist China, great numbers of refugees began to flow into Hong Kong. There was great sympathy in this country for those refugees, but our immigration laws tell us we could only take 100 a year. Now, it would have made a difference if we could have taken 2,000 or 3,000 in that specific crisis. And I don't think it would have undermined the republic. I don't think it would have raised racial problems. And yet it would have made a tremendous difference in our stance vis-a-vis the Chinese communists. That's the kind of situation I have in mind. No one is thinking of 10 million Chinese or Asian immigrants, but a couple of thousand at the right point could make a tremendous difference.
Well, does our past experience with immigrant groups provide us with any guidelines for handling what might be called the present immigration of Puerto Ricans?
Only to a limited extent, because while the Puerto Ricans have some similarities to the immigrants of the past, they are also in many ways different. They're American citizens, of course. They're not foreigners in the sense that the European immigrants were. They retain closer ties to their island home. They're able to go back and forth more readily than people could to Italy or Poland in the 19th century. More important, their lives are complicated by the question of color, which makes their adjustment additionally difficult and puts social barriers in their way in every part of our country. And finally, they're coming into a society in which the demand for unskilled labor is shrinking. In the 19th century, the European immigrants always found a tremendous need for their services, just as hands. And now, with automation, we find that unemployment is particularly severe in the unskilled sectors of the population. And there's a real question as to whether we can absorb many additional people without skills. Well, all these factors set off the contemporary Puerto Rican problem from that of the 19th century European immigrants. And yet there are similarities also, similarities which come out of the experiences of people who move into strange homes, but do so in a free society which still has a tradition of treating each individual as a worthwhile person in his own rights.
Well, do you think they'll be able to solve this problem by themselves through perhaps education or politics, as many immigrant groups seem to have done?
I hope so. I think the Puerto Ricans have been slower to develop autonomous institutions and slower to move into politics than some of their predecessors. But we must remember that the big immigration is only 15 years old or so, that the second generation has not yet had an opportunity to assert itself, and that the effects of the environment have not yet begun to play themselves out. In 10 or 15 years from now, we'll be in a better position to judge that. But I think there is enough basis to hope that they will be as successful in their adjustment as their predecessors were.
Well, for another minority group, which has been with us for more than 10 or 15 years, the Negroes, freedom rides and sit-in demonstrations now seem to be frequent occurrences. Are there any historical precedents for these?
No, these are new developments. In the past, the normal processes of political change and economic adjustment were adequate to enable people to achieve their own objectives in life. Here, we have a frustrated group which is now seeking its ends through very novel techniques.
In a recent article in the Times, in a book review, you included this phrase that moderate gains have whetted rather than satisfied the appetite for social justice, and people long victims of prejudice are inclined to demand not only that the law be impartial, but also that it act positively on their behalf, not only to provide equal treatment, but preferential treatment. Are direct action techniques the most effective way for minority groups to achieve their rights, or do they seem to go overboard?
Well, they ought not to be the most effective way. If our democratic processes worked directly and effectively, then there'd be no point to sit-ins or pray-ins or demonstrations of these of this kind. They are used by people who begin to lose confidence in the political and economic methods of improving their situation. It's now 9 years since the Supreme Court decision abolished segregation. That means that a whole generation of school children has grown up and passed beyond the schooling age without having the rights that the court held were theirs. And these outbursts come not throughout the country. They come particularly in those states which have been using government not as a means of asserting the interests of the whole population of the state or of expressing their will, but as an instrument of oppression. And therefore, the people who don't have legitimate ways of expressing themselves through government are driven to these extra-legal tactics which are the only ones that are available to them. I think they're regrettable, but they're inevitable. As long as the government of Mississippi or Alabama retains its present undemocratic character, it will be met by extra-legal and undemocratic means of protest.
Professor Hanlon, on another subject, in a recent article in Commentary magazine, you took serious issue with a frequently heard contention that during the Nazi Holocaust, millions of European Jews died because they failed to resist. This contention seems to suggest, in a sense, that they collaborated in their own destruction. How would you comment on that?
Well, I think there is evidence that shows that there was serious resistance, and that the Jews were not peculiar in the way in which they faced up to the Nazi challenge. The real problem arises from the fact that we are unwilling to believe that a catastrophe of this character could really have happened if people just didn't accept it without resistance. If we face up to the fact that the instruments of destruction that any modern state has now are so terrible, the capacity of resistance is so minor, we have to think also that it's only when a government is informed by a moral purpose that it can contain its actions within legitimate ends.
On the basis of this whole discussion, on balance, do you think we should be confident or concerned about the health of liberty in the United States today?
I think we should be concerned, but not despairing. There are great problems in the survival of liberty, problems which come out of the massive qualities of modern life, out of the growth of government, and indeed out of the growth of other organizations, on the problems which arise out of all the pressures on the individual to conform to molds over which he has no control. All these are serious subjects of concern. I think we should not despair, because the important elements in the preservation of liberty are those which make people want to be free. There is enough in our tradition and in our history to show that against substantial obstacles, that desire can be asserted meaningfully and can result in the creation of an atmosphere in which liberty can flourish. We're in trouble, but we're not in a hopeless situation.
Thank you very much, Dr. Hanlon.
If you would like a copy of today's program, please send your name and address, with 10 cents to cover the cost of postage and handling, to the Jewish Theological Seminary of America, 3080 Broadway, New York 27, New York. Our Eternal Light program today was the second in a series of four conversations with distinguished leaders of modern thought. Our guest was Dr. Oscar Hanlon, Winthrop Professor of History at Harvard University and Pulitzer Prize-winning author. He was interviewed by NBC News correspondent Ed Goff. Editorial consultant for this program was Robert Allison. We invite you to join us next week at this same time for a conversation with the eminent statesman, the Honorable Herbert H. Lehman. This is Vic Robey. This weekly Peabody Award-winning program is produced under the auspices of the Jewish Theological Seminary of America. This pre-recorded program has been an NBC Public Affairs presentation.
If you're tired of talking about a better world and want to help build one, serve in the Peace Corps. For information, write Peace Corps, Washington 25, D.C. This is NBC, the National Broadcasting Company.